Belinda Audio presents this unabridged recording of Blood Sinister, written by Celia Rees and read by Shirley Barthelmie. The dedication reads, For Catherine. Thanks to Mayan Sun, Pyasu, and Jovi, class of 95, for help and advice about the Kangxi. Part 1. Take care, he said. Take care how you cut yourself. It is more dangerous than you think. Count Dracula's advice to Jonathan Harker. Dracula by Bram Stoker. Chapter 1. Ellen Forrest was not ill. Not really. At least she didn't feel it most of the time. Just tired. And everyone got tired. Everyone woke in the night, hot and sweaty one minute and chilly the next. It was a common experience. It happened to everybody now and again. Not as much as you. Not as much as it does to you, the little voice said in her head. Lots of people got colds and sore throats, she argued back. Loads felt flu-y and achy. It was going to be a bad winter for it. They'd said so on the telly. Rain drove against the windscreen as they swished through the wet November streets. There were not many pedestrians on the usually crowded London pavements. Those who had come out stumbled along, scowling and bent, coats wrapped around them. Ellen shivered, glad she was in the car. Are you all right, dear? Her mother did not turn from her driving, but her voice came over sharp with concern. Are you sure you're warm enough? In the rearview mirror, anxious eyes searched for hers. There should be a shawl somewhere on the back seat. Perhaps you should put it on. I'm fine, Mum. Honestly, don't fuss. Well said. Her grandmother's lined face creased further as she smiled from the front passenger seat. Her blue eyes, magnified by thick spectacle lenses, flashed a powerful message of support to Ellen. Leave the child alone, Stella. She's 16. Not a toddler. She's swaddled up enough as it is. But the specialist said... Ellen sighed and leaned back in her seat. Her mother had put on her special doctor voice and was going through it all again for the 100th time. The symptoms, what they thought it was, what they thought it might be, what they definitely knew it wasn't. And, Ellen suppressed a shudder, then there were the tests. Hollow needles, spurting liquid. Long, shiny tubes, ruby red with blood, snaking in or out of her. This won't hurt a bit. But it always did. Ellen stared out at the slick, wet streets, trying not to feel sick. The fact of the matter is, Edith Baxter said, cutting into her granddaughter's medical history, they haven't got a clue what's wrong with her. Her old, arthritic hand groped the back of her seat, feeling for Ellen's. That's why she's here. Meanwhile, she's not an invalid, and I, for one, don't intend to treat her as such. Ah, we're here. The car swung into the short drive. Shrubs and tall trees grew close up, shutting the tall Victorian house off from the street. It showed no welcoming light, and in the late afternoon, as day edged towards night, it looked gloomy, forbidding, even creepy. Not as creepy as what's across the road, Ellen told herself, deliberately not looking in that direction. You couldn't see much, really, not from street level, just a high wall topped with railings. It curved the whole length of the road, marking the boundary of the oldest part of one of the biggest cemeteries in London. Almost directly opposite her grandmother's house was one of the gates. Strictly no admittance, a peeling notice said, but they were no longer in use. They hadn't been opened in 30 years. Saplings had grown up, weaving through the rusting bars, adding their living strength to the chains and padlocks. Everything was so overgrown, it looked like a forest. You couldn't even see the path behind. From above, from the top of Gran's house, it was possible to see more. The dirty white marble of crumbling mausoleums gleamed through the canopy of leaves, and, here and there, fallen granite columns and broken stone angels showed in gaps in the greenery. Some of the damage had been done by vandals, but mostly it was the work of trees, now huge, full-grown, thrusting root and trunk through bone, wood and stone. It was a wild place, strange and dangerous. Public notices barred access for good reason. There were no real pathways left, it was easy to get lost, and the ground was honeycombed with crumbling vaults and passages. In some places, huge holes yawned under a thin disguise of grass and brambles. In others, one step was enough to break through rotten brick to a pit deep enough to hide a house. Besides, even on the brightest day, it was a place of shadows. Crowded on all sides by streets and houses, it remained an island of eerie silence. She had never explored the tangled interior, only seen it from the attic. Andy had. She hadn't seen him for years, but when she was a kid and had come to stay, he'd always been round to play. He knew the cemetery like the back of his hand, or said he did. One day he'd dared them to go in there with him. Ellen and her sister Karen had said, "No way!" So he'd gone on his own. That was morning, and he didn't emerge until late afternoon. He'd gone straight home, pale and subdued, and had never said a word about what, if anything, had taken place. "Can you manage?" Her mother had come round to open the car door and help her out. "Of course I can. I told you before, Mum, don't fuss over me. I'm not a baby." But even as she said the words, she felt the strength draining from her, leaving her legs useless and wobbly. Despite herself, she had to lean against the car to gather her strength for the walk to the steps. Because she was sick. She was very sick. She could feel it deep down inside when it overtook her like this, see it in her mother's anxious stare and her grandmother's look of sudden sadness. A row of holly bushes, dark and bulky, cut the view of the cemetery down to patches of brick. It looked like any other wall. You'd never guess what lay behind it. Ellen found herself wondering what exactly had happened in there. What kind of experience could it be to affect a boy like Andy and scare him witless? Chapter 2. The next day she felt fine again, even had an appetite. Her grandmother brought her breakfast in bed and she ate it all, even the boiled egg, which wasn't exactly a favourite. It was like that, this mystery sickness. It came and went. There was something wrong with her, but no one could discover what. Something wrong with her blood. That was all they knew, or all they were saying to her. Their manner had changed over the year since it had all started. The cheery, "We'll soon have you right as rain, young lady," remarks had gradually faltered. Reassuring smiles had turned into puzzled shakes of the head. Now, if they talked at all, it was to each other, or to her father and mother, always just out of earshot, out in the corridor, or in sister's office. Her case had been referred to one of the big London teaching hospitals. Mum had gone back, leaving her at Gran's. It was nearer to the specialist consultants and their dedicated unit. All she had to do was wait to be called in, so they could get another round of tests started.
"I'm going out now, dear. Do you want anything from the shops?"
Gran came in, already dressed for the raw weather outside. The purples and greens of her tweed coat matched her soft-brimmed hat. A mauve Angora scarf pinned at her throat with an amethyst brooch completed the ensemble.
"Miss, or just 17, Ellen said from the bed. "They're magazines," she added. "I know that. I don't live in a time warp," her grandmother replied. "I'm quite aware that newsagents stock other items besides Woman's Journal and Homes and Gardens."
Ellen smiled. She quite enjoyed Gran's sharp tongue.
"Well, I'm off," Edith Baxter said, pulling on fur-lined gloves. "No need to lie about feeling sorry for yourself. Besides the television, there's plenty of books to read. Annie is downstairs if you need anything. I'll see you later."
Ellen dressed and sat on the side of the bed, wondering what to do. Annie's singing filtered up the stairs from the bottom of the house. She didn't really want to go down and make polite conversation. Gran's home help knew why she was there and was bound to cluck over her and ask questions. Instead, she left her room and headed in the opposite direction, up the little flight of stairs which led to the attic. She had been up there before, of course, with Andy. Karen, her sister, never came up. She was younger than Ellen and scaredy. One year they had made up some story about a ghost to stop her tagging along with them. Something about a headless body in a trunk and presences. Karen had been so terrified she wouldn't even sleep on the floor below, had made Ellen swap beds. She smiled. Karen could really drive her round the bend, but suddenly she missed her sister. The eaves sloped inwards, in an inverted V, but the attics were proper rooms, not a trapdoor in the ceiling like at home. They were packed, floor to ceiling, with all kinds of junk, but there was still plenty of space to move about. Ellen looked around, trying to ward off the sense of disappointment creeping through her. She used to look forward to this, exploring, looking for secrets. Now, everything appeared to be exactly what it actually was. Stuff that had been banished from the rest of the house. Chairs with wonky legs, a leather settee with horsehair poking out. Things belonging to Grandad. Fishing rods and cricket bats. Ancient tennis rackets with broken catgut strings, piled up in corners. It was like the old wardrobe. She and Andy had climbed in, expecting to find a route to a magic world. But there was no way out. Just a couple of hairy old sports coats swinging in front of a solid plywood back. They had practically pulled the old desk apart, looking for secret compartments and hidden springs, but had found nothing but old bills and broken pencils. She sat down in a deeply sagging armchair, her feet on the box in front of her. It wasn't a box, in fact, it was a trunk, green tin with leather hinges. She leaned forward, examining it more carefully. She didn't remember it from the last time. Someone must have been moving things. It was not big enough to hide a body in, except a very small one. The trunk was a bit the worse for wear, the pale pea-green paint badly scratched, the top all bashed. It had letters on the side, faintly stenciled in what must have been gold, E-L-M. Secured with a sturdy padlock, iron and brass, it was rather smart. No key, but then there wouldn't be. Ellen leaned over and tried the hasp. It was secured by rust, apart from anything else, but that didn't matter, because the whole lid was loose. The leather of the hinges had perished, nearly rotted through. It looked like mice had been nibbling away at them, too. She retrieved an old broken penknife from the desk drawer. Using it like a saw, she released the straps and flipped open the box. At first she thought it was just like the desk, full of an unrewarding jumble of old papers, but these did appear to be slightly more interesting. There were photographs and newspaper cuttings among what looked like personal letters, and something else. Ellen pushed the sheets of paper to one side. A book jutted out, and beneath that another, going down like steps to the bottom of the trunk. She took one out and looked at the cover. It was about the same size as an exercise book, but stiffly bound in dark blue, with a leather back and reinforced corners. Logbook was stamped in gold letters on the front, and the pages were edged in thin, wavy bands of rainbow colours. Ellen, who had never kept a diary for more than a few days, could feel the pull of the book, the desire to have it, to write in and fill with words of your own. She opened the cover, aware of its age, careful of the creaking back, not wanting to hurt it. Ellen Laidlaw, Her Book, 1878. To keep this safe from prying eyes, cursed be he who looks inside. A square of white paper was gummed on to the marbled inside cover. The verse was accompanied by a little devil drawn in red ink, complete with a horrible grimacing face, pitchfork and nest of flames licking all around him. The handwriting was copperplate, small and incredibly neat, sloping to the right, with loops above and below the lines. Executed well over 100 years ago, Indian ink had kept the letters fresh and black. Ellen looked at the page, her heart beating fast. This was a discovery. There might be secrets here. The writer, Ellen.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.